I'm Jennifer Gunn. I'm the director of the Institute for Advanced Study, and welcome to IAS Thursdays. I'm going to make a couple of announcements before I introduce today's speaker. So next week, same time, same place, our speaker will be Kyla Wazana Tompkins, who's a food writer and faculty member in the Departments of English and Gender Studies at Pomona College, and she'll be speaking on deformalism, fermentation, abstraction, and the effective organization of racial carcerality. And this is a Winton Chair cornerstone event that we are co-sponsoring with the Winton Chair. Today's speaker, Jeffrey Howe, is the Chair of the Department of Landscape Architecture in the College of Built Environments at the University of Washington. And perhaps not surprisingly, today's talk is co-sponsored by the School of Architecture and the Departments of Landscape Architecture and Design, Housing, and Apparel. So thank you all very much for co-sponsoring. He earned his master's in landscape architecture from the University of Pennsylvania and a master's in architecture and a PhD in environmental planning from the University of California at Berkeley. Professor Howe's research, teaching, and practice really spanned the US and also the Pacific. And his focus has been on community design, design activism, cross-cultural learning, and engagement of marginalized communities in planning, design, and placemaking. He received a Community Builder Award and a Golden Circle Award for his service in Seattle's Chinatown International District. And he co-founded and served as coordinator of the Pacific Rim Community Design Network. He is an author and editor, sometimes with others, of more than six award-winning books, including three in the last 3 years, and one more forthcoming soon. So this kind of prolific productivity is extremely impressive to other academics. And those titles include Now Urbanism, The Future City is Here, Messy Urbanism, Understanding the Other Cities of Asia, and most recently, City Unsilenced, Urban Resistance, and Public Space in the Age of Shrinking Democracy. So let's welcome Professor Howe.
Thank you, Jennifer. And thank you to the Institute for the invitation, to Daniela for seeking me out, and also to the kindness of many friends and colleagues who drove me around the city yesterday, invited me to studios and so forth. It's been I've been having a very good time here. As a planning and design scholar, the kind of work I do is not exactly mainstream. Okay, it is not intended to be mainstream, and so it's reassuring to know that there are people who also interested in the kind of work that I do, although I know there's a captive audience here, so they have to be here anyway. Okay, let me begin. So the title of my talk today is Public Space Activism and the Actually Existing Commons, which I will talk more in very shortly. Public space activism is a social political phenomenon that's been around for quite some time. In 1971, citizens in Stockholm gathered to protect a beloved grove of elm tree at the King's Garden from being chopped down to make way for a subway station. It's one of the early examples of Occupy before the term was used. The unprecedented act led to led the city to re-examine ways to better engage the citizens in the planning process. In the early 1990s, Reclaim the Streets emerged as a movement in London as a way to take back the streets from automobiles and reclaim the street as belonging to the citizens, an early example of the temporary autonomy zone in which citizens temporarily occupy the streets to stage events and to make a political statement. It was also around this time, in the early 90s, that critical mass movement began in San Francisco. The monthly gathering of cyclists became a tradition that continued to this day in the city around the world. All these actions and movements share a couple of things in common. First, public space, whether it's streets, you know, urban open spaces, is something intrinsic to our culture, society, and democracy. And then secondly, the public space itself can become an effective vehicle for mobilization and for the display of citizen power. In recent years, we see this form of public space activism taking on a more urgent and political tone, but one that continues to embody the same kind of duality. First, the public space is a concept. It's a notion, something that's shared by us all, something that's intrinsic to our democracy. And then secondly, public space is a vehicle for mobilization, for protest, for communication. And this obviously happened with the Occupy Wall Street movement, as well as the protest at Gezi Park in Istanbul, a movement to protect the public realm from the encroachment of the state and the market. Public space is something to be protected and as a stage for action. Google Bus blockade in San Francisco function very much the same way, defending not only the streets but also the livelihood from corporate interests and from the forces of transportation. So this is one of the books that Jennifer mentions, so this is kind of like advertising. It's coming out in July, by the way. So I've been working on this book, City on Science, with a colleague of mine in Vienna, Sabine Neumann, to examine these recent instances of public space activism, particularly their significance as a form of resistance against the forces of enclosure coming from the corporate state, state increasingly serving the interests of corporations and expenses of democracy and society. And I've been interested in this line of work for quite some time, starting with the book Insurgent Public Space, and in which I was primarily interested in public space as created by people vis-a-vis institutions. So how, and also how that occurred often outside or at the border of the regulatory domain. So things are not exactly kind of sanctioned by the authority that can exhibit and embody the agencies of individuals and communities. Example include the case of Beijing residents, especially rural migrants, occupying the residual spaces in the city for social and recreational activities, as well as the early form of our parking day, which started out as a temporary Guerrilla Act in San Francisco, but then has become institutionalized and over time. In the book Transcultural City, I was interested in how places and placemaking transform social relationships, particularly relationship between different cultural groups. In other words, how public space can perform as a vehicle for engendering cross-cultural understanding. And so for example, how community gardens enable refugees and local residents to work side by side. How they allow people from different ethnic or cultural backgrounds to share a meal or a conversation. And how public spaces engender these everyday interactions. How specific actors, in this case, the social work students and faculty working at the Holland Partners Center at the University of Utah, can facilitate that process. Okay, so sometimes it takes more than just the space or the place itself. You need the people to actually function as these kind of facilitators and connectors to make things happen. A process that requires working through discomforts, misunderstanding. But also a process that creates opportunity for face-to-face interaction, opportunity for overcoming and respecting differences. And so from the more kind of explicit form of public space activism to this more everyday appropriation of public space, I'm taking you through these kind of examples to really kind of argue that public space can be a medium through which our relationship with the city, urban spaces, government institutions, market economy, and with each other, a citizen can be re-examined, redefined, disrupted, and reassembled. In other words, public space, or more precisely, insurgent public space, your public spaces created by people, can be a vehicle for reconstructing the urban commons. Commons in the sense of social relationship and social production, not just in material commons. So it's articulated by Michael Hart and Antonio Negri and many others. So looking at, you know, this more fluid kind of global commons that exists in our contemporary society. And such kind of reconstruction of social relationship, these commons can become the space of hope, space of resistance, and space of new assemblages. So all that sounds pretty good, right? But how do these commons actually exist? Particularly when institutions, existing social norms, new political forces, you know, market forces are all around us, okay? Almost kind of inescapable. How do these commons actually exist in the reality? What are these kind of actually existing commons, to borrow a term or phrase that has been used in similar kind of contexts when it comes to democracy and neo-liberalization, and so forth. So for the rest of my talk today, I would like to use this framework to explore some of the examples I've come across, specifically in East Asia, where I've been spending some time kind of in recent years in my research, and where they have been kind of phenomenal kind of social changes that are happening in the society, along with a growing number of kind of social experiments that are exemplary of you know, what we can define as the actual existing commons. And there are many examples that range from Curry Caravan in Tokyo, which is a project founded by a group of people that creates temporary social spaces throughout the city by cooking curry rice. Okay? And you can imagine, you know, the kind of flavor and the aroma of curry, you know, become something that can attract people to interact with each other, promote sharing, engender social interaction. This is a store that is set up in a park, and the one year I happened to be visiting, and as they were setting up, people begin to kind of come by, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. And then when they start cooking, more people show up because they smell food. They wonder what, you know, how is this happening in the public park? Why are people cooking curry rice in the public park? And then they realize they can actually eat the curry rice. And it becomes this whole chain reaction one after another. And people start to talk to each other, telling each other stories, and finding more about kind of why this group of people wanted to do this for free. You're not paying money for the curry rice. You are basically, you know, engaging in this kind of convivial activity for free. So from that kind of example to Yuzhou in Seoul, which happens to be a city government support initiative. Okay, so something that's completely independent to something that is supported by the institutions. And so in this case, the intent here was to create what they call a gravity-free zone, basically stress-free. So Korea is it's highly stressful society, especially for young people. You know, entrance exam, you know, job, and so forth. And so the idea is to create a place where people can feel free to interact with each other. And this also happened to serve as a sort of incubator for even social startups. So from that kind of initiative to another one, which is the Fix in Hong Kong group, that which is an activist organization that emerged pretty much during and after the Umbrella Revolution in the fall of 2014. It started out as a group of artisans and repairmen who helped build the study area in the protest that allows students to study for exam. And so they can go back to school and take the exam and then come back to protest. So rather peculiar form of street protest that speaks to the particular conditions in Hong Kong. So after the movement dissipated, the same group of artisans and repairmen, they wanted to kind of continue their activism. Okay? They have never engaged in this kind of activism before, so it's very kind of empowering. And they wanted to continue the work that they started with, you know, building of the study area. But it was very difficult, and people in Hong Kong were generally quite apathetic to, you know, talking about politics, or, you know, sometimes even talking to strangers. And so they came up with this idea, because these are repairmen, so they know how to do their home repair. And so they came up with this idea of offering free home repair services in order to get people to open their door and talk. And so this is their model. So fixing Hong Kong first by fixing the community. And so if you go to their Facebook page, you get to see, you know, this collection of photographs that you can find where they perform repair, through which they begin to engage the local resident in conversation about, you know, politics and democracy, and why it's important for people to participate in the democratic process and to voice their opinion and to raise their political consciousness. And in the process, they also kind of started to build kind of interpersonal ties, you know, with residents, neighbors, and begin to expand kind of their network. And it was kind of funny, I interviewed these people, and so they'll tell me that sometimes they come across like jobs that are very simple that would take like a minute or two to fix, okay, and that is not long enough to engage in a substantive conversation. So they'll tell the residents they forgot something, they need to go back and to get it, or this actually will take much longer. So they would take, you know, what would otherwise take a 3 minutes to finish a job that takes three minutes to finish. Instead, it'll take like 3 hours, or sometimes even 3 days, to finish in order to have an in-depth conversation with the people that they hope to reach out. So people became very creative when they come to this kind of things. So I had the opportunity to shadow the group one evening in 2015 when I got a small grant to do some field work there. And it was interesting to see the impact of the group work in the community, not only in terms of kind of building interpersonal ties with the local residents, and also kind of promote, you know, political awareness, but also in terms of creating a network of volunteers. Okay, so not just repairmen by this point; they're also college students, social work staff. They were also, and this is kind of one phenomenon I come across very often. Like, you know, white collar office worker who are completely bored of their jobs, and so they wanted to do something meaningful, and one way of doing that is through volunteering for these types of social service organizations. Okay, so there are many examples. I won't have time, so what I want to focus on now is to really kind of zoom in on one particular setting, in this case Taipei. So in 2015, I was quite fortunate to receive a Fulbright grant to carry out more in-depth kind of research, looking at similar types of initiative and actions, particularly. And I was looking at especially the kind of actors and processes, as well as kind of social institutional context in which these kind of commonly initiative emerge. And so I'll just highlight a few. I won't go through everything. There won't be time to do that. One of the first project organization that I looked at was Do Your Flavor. So do your favor, but do your flavor, because they are working with food. This is a group of young people, mostly recent college graduates, who focus their work on helping marginalized social groups. So many homeless people, street vendors in particular. So there's, you know, programmer, a business school grad. It's really interesting kind of ensemble of people, you know, coming together. Let's see. And so their inspiration, so the reason that they started this line of work actually came from their participation in a protest movement that happened in the spring of 2014, the Sunflower Movement, in which citizens in Taiwan, particularly young college students, occupied the chamber in the national legislature Taiwan for 23 consecutive days. Okay. Imagine this happening in our capital. This would be something that would be the worst contract. Anyway, so, and and the protest was staged to express the opposition against the passage of a trade agreement with China that would undermine thousands of small and medium businesses in the country, jobs and opportunity for young people, as well as giving China more political influence in the country. And specifically, the members of Do Your Flavor, they will volunteer to help manage the supply, the donated supply, including perishable food. And there were much more supply that they were able to consume. So they decided to give them away, especially the perishable food, because they want to, you know, make them usable, you know, before the food expired. But apparently, there's no food bank in the city, where there's no formalized kind of network of kind of food bank. And they also realized that they didn't actually know much about the homeless, you know, community in Taipei. And so this kind of impelled them to really start looking into this issue and to start an organization to address that particular issue. So one of their first projects was Stone Soup. So inspired by the same story I think most of you are familiar with. The idea here is to solicit donated food materials and volunteers. And they will cook together, they'll share a meal with the homeless people on the streets. This is a website that they put together to recruit volunteers to solicit food supplies and organize cooking and sharing. So you know, anybody can join it. You put their, type in their name, address, you know, whether, you know, what they can provide in terms of time or food materials and so forth. And hundreds and hundreds of people signed up. And these are mostly strangers and young people who do not have any sort of connection with each other. So in 2 years, they have close to about 30 events, typically the last weekend of each month. They'll get together and you know, cook together and eat with the homeless people. And they don't just hand out the food, which is what kind of most, you know, social service organizations do. The point of this activity is really actually to sit down with the homeless people and share the meal with them. And partly because I think through their interaction with homeless people, they realized that the lack of income was not was one of the issues, but was not the only issue. The other issue had to do with the social isolation that homeless people experienced in the city, the kind of stigma they were attached to. So eating the meal together with homeless people was a way of them to kind of get across that. With the success of this Stone Soup project, they then applied for a grant from Oxfam to support another project focusing on helping the street vendors. So these are the kind of street vendors that you find on street corners in Taipei selling pens or bubble gums for a small change, so rather than just asking for money. And the way they did this was through this kind of hackathon style workshop, and which is quite prevalent among young people. And so it was used as a way to recruit volunteers and to come up with kind of different solutions to address this particular social group. So out of the workshop came the idea for designing new merchandise for the vendor to sell and to create this kind of alternative economy that will connect street vendor in the city to organic farmers and producers in the countryside, and also to socially conscious consumers everywhere. And so it's become this, basically it's a social enterprise kind of approach to address social issues. And so these are some of the products that they developed, dry banana chips, black tea. This is really good tea, by the way. So again, linking vendors, producers, and consumers together in this kind of new economy. And they also print the percentage of profit that went into the producers and vendors and the social startup, kind of respectively. So that's kind of one example that I came across that actually came out of a social movement, similar to the Fixing Hong Kong group. Another group that I looked at, which also came out of the social, Sunflower movement, was this group called the 9th Floor Co-Living Apartments. And
this is their website. You know, started out with kind of one location about 2 years ago. They are now 9 different locations. Okay, a bit hipsterish in terms of the style, which young people really like these days in Taiwan. But at least this is what it looks like on the website. This is this is the reality. This is the everyday space. So the concept of a co-living apartment, I mentioned before, this group came out of the Sunflower Movement. And the way they came about is that during the Sunflower Movement, they have friends that came from other cities to stay with them during the protest. Okay? And at one point, there were like over 20 or 30 people living in like one bedroom apartment unit. And it was just unbearable. And so they started to look for like larger spaces. And you know, the protest lasted for almost a month. And it was very expensive to live in Taipei, and not to mention like trying to find a decent size and space for a large group of people. And most young people could not could not afford to live in the city center anyway. So they came up with this idea of if they can keep a room nice and clean, they can actually lease it out through Airbnb. So and then use the revenue to subsidize other tenants in the apartments, who are mostly students and young professionals who don't have a lot of money and will not be able to afford living in the city center otherwise. And so that's the room that they usually you keep for the guests. And then these are what the other rooms look like. So the gentleman there is Pan. He's actually one of the co-founder of this group, and that's his bed right there. What's interesting about 9-4 is that besides kind of functioning as this kind of what they call co-living apartments, they will host all kinds of events, and with like artists, filmmakers, and so forth, to really kind of create an alternative community, okay? Community in which people can have other source of relationship beyond just being tenants living in the same space. And then they will also partner with other social startups to host other types of events. So this one in particular is called Southeast Asia Sundays. It's a informal gatherings of migrant workers. And anyone who's interested in sharing a meal will enjoy the opportunity to interact with people from different culture. And so the group is called 140, which represent the fact that 140 of Taiwan's population right now consists of migrant workers. And so it's another social startup that is designed to serve that particular population. And so this event is open to anyone as well. So similar to their Do Your Flavor, they have a website, a Facebook, one can sign up, one can find out on the schedule of the Sunday events, and then you sign up to participate. And so I signed myself up for one of these events, and I went, half of the people, they don't know each other, and I don't know any one of them except it was hosted at the 9-4 apartment, so I knew the one of the co-founders, and that was about it. It was opportunities for like people who have no previous connection to migrant workers to have face-to-face opportunity for face-to-face interaction to an individual rather than a stereotype, and vice versa. 140 itself is also a really interesting organization whose mission is to serve, again, migrant workers, mostly from Indonesia, Philippines, and Thailand. Through activities and program, one particular one is called what they call a migrant business school. And because the organization was founded by business school grads, and so they thought they can actually apply their skill into something that would be useful to the migrant workers. And the idea is to provide the migrant worker with business skills so that when they return to their home country, they are better prepared to start a business, which is often what they are interested in doing. But don't necessarily have the skill to do so. And similar to other organizations I mentioned before, they work, their work relied mostly on volunteers. the only two full-time staff, and they get grants donation to make this work. But the bulk of the work relies on volunteers to make it possible. Okay, and there'll be other kind of types of groups. One of which is it's a new kind of rising phenomenon of makerspace, and which represent another sort of commons in Taipei. This is Fab Lab Taipei, the very first makerspace in the country. It was started in somebody's apartment. And in many ways, it really looks like somebody's living room. It happened to be a makerspace. And when I was there that particular evening, you can see how it really functioned as a social space. So anybody can come. At one point, they used to charge a membership fee, but they realized that when people pay a fee, they actually expect service. So it's better not to have that kind of expectation. And so they make it free, anybody can sign up. You have to go through some sort of training. But they can easily recover the cost from donation, from fundraising with a company and so forth. So that particular evening, so they were like brainstorming on this the box war events, so something like this, okay? Right. It brings together people who previously had no connection to each other, but they have something in common. And in this case, was their interest in making. And then since the establishment of Fab Lab Taipei, there have been many other maker spaces in the city. This one is probably the most interesting one that I have come across. There's no other maker space like it. It's called the White Hub because it occupies this kind of white exterior color building. They first started out as a tool library for neighbors. So what happened was that there was an event in a social event in the community in which they were engaged in building something, and then they collected all these tools from neighbors. So they decided to create a tool library so that people can share the tool. They don't have to buy tools just to do a project. And over time, it evolved into this kind of community repair station and makerspace where neighbors and non-neighbors can come and learn about repairing small household appliances, furniture, and so forth. And the person that really made this happen was that this gentleman in the middle, Mr. Wen, who happened to be a retired engineer, and is an absolute kind of genius when it comes to doing repair. And so he started to volunteer his time once a week for like 2 or 3 hours. And people started to come over and trying to seek help from him. And the facility is open to everybody, so neighbors and non-neighbors alike. And then people start to come, and there are more and more kind of volunteers. And then Mr. Wen started to have apprentices, okay, including other retired people who kind of lived alongside to him. But instead of preparing for residents, the volunteer here, the goal is really to teach people how to fix appliances themselves. So on the right, you're looking at a woman fixing their rice cooker. And then in addition to the purposes of repair, makerspace, the space is also functioning for all kinds of other neighborhood events, including this training workshop for community designers, event that's open to both neighbors and non-neighbors alike. And it turns out that Mr. Wen is not a neighbor himself. He actually come from another part of the city, but somehow found out about this space and then was recruited to come here for a few hours a week. So after he started to do this, he realized that he has a lot of kind of knowledge to share, and there's not enough time. So he started to create this catalog or manual, which you see over here. So this is a manual for fixing blender. And it's all hand-drawn, okay? And and everything, he did this all by himself. And there's a whole catalog of it, like all kinds of appliances. So blender, electrical fan, you know, rice cooker, you know, name it, it's all in this personal catalog. So I think what, you know, spaces like this does is that it help kind of bring people out of you know, community, the people who have a lot to offer but don't often have the opportunity to do so. So what began as a repair hour is kind of spiral into other kind of, you know, programs, and they're kind of often, you know, strategically kind of schedule a different time to engage like different part of the community, people who have different kind of work hours and different schedule. And so what is happening now is that they have so many volunteers and there's not enough space and time. And so the volunteers at White House begin to branch out and to help support development of other maker spaces around the city. So this one is called the Timber Hut. It's another neighborhood. Again, kind of turning a vacant unused space into a community workshop and a maker space. That's me doing my participant observation. Okay, the last example that I wanted to share is the South Airport apartments. So this is a resettlement house, actually built with American foreign aid back in the 60s. The building was finished, so that's what it looked like in 1968 when it was first built. It was the most advanced apartment building in the city, and then over time it's become this kind of enclave of low-income community. And what was interesting also about this particular project was that there was a, when we first started, there was a, the basement was designed as a marketplace, okay? But unfortunately, the market kind of went out of business, or they, you know, had to compete with other markets outside in the neighborhood. And has, so it was no longer in operation, that's been vacant for many years. Until this young person came along, the guy on the left, Zibai, who's happened to be a young graduate from a local architecture school, and who saw the potential of the space to, you know, to do more. And so he applied for a government grant to fix it up and to invite others to kind of begin to kind of program the space. The lady on the left, on the right, is actually the manager of the government grant. She seemed more excited than him. And I happened to be on the jury that reviewed and approved this grant proposal. So I got to see, you know, some of the processes behind the scene. So in less than a year, this is what the space now looks like. It now hosts multiple social service organizations doing different kinds of things. So there's one organization, it's called City Dreamers, and that provides job training to homeless individuals. And the space that they occupy here functions as a carpentry workshop. Okay, so people will come here, take lessons. They also use the space to actually manufacture kind of small scale kind of carpentry projects. So that's one group. Another group, this one is called Nanji Rice. And it's actually a project of Do You a Flavor. So the first organization that I mentioned in the beginning. And they did not have a fixed location before, but they now have this kind of physical kind of space to do something more community-based work. And so this was done in collaboration with other NGOs, and it really functioned as a community kitchen. Okay? So the project that started out, you know, by this kind of monthly kind of cooking gathering now has a physical kind of base in their community. So and this is what I mentioned earlier about kind of more fluid form of kind of commoning that is kind of emerging in the city. And again, so this is you know, the residents and volunteer, they come here not only to, you know, not only to kind of donate, you know, food material, they also eat together, cook together, and also provide services to those in need. So these are some of the photographs I'll go through very quickly. And they also deliver, you know, these kind of bento boxes to elderly residents who are not able to come to the space and who may or may not live, you know, in the same apartment complex. they also host other events. So there's a movie night, there's afternoon workshop, there's a, they started recently a pay-as-you-wish restaurant. So we go, you can, you know, depending on your income, or depending on how the food tastes, you can pay as much as you want. But ideas to really kind of, it's a more kind of a way of creating this kind of convivial experience for people. And, you know, money is not an issue here. Okay, so I had a chance to kind of visit the space as well. And so this is one evening where the staff, the volunteers, and the residents would eat together, share food, stories, etc. Okay, so I'm going to start to kind of wrap up here. And so going back to this phrase that I mentioned earlier, the actually existing commons, what I want to do now is to offer you a few observations that I've made looking at this range of cases in Taipei in particular. You know, so what are the characteristics of these kind of emerging kind of, you know, community projects, commons, and what really what enabled them to work, at least up to this point. So first, obviously social media, social networking tool have been playing a very critical role, and Taiwan happens to be happens to have the highest user rate of Facebook in Asia. Not in the world, I don't know the statistic actual kind of data that represent that, but at least in Asia, they're at the highest user rate there. And so, like, almost everybody is on Facebook, okay? If you're not on Facebook, then you don't know what's going on, or you don't have friends, or, you know. at least among the young people, but it's starting to be among the older people as well. And so what Facebook and other social media, social networking tool does is that it enables messages to be spreading very quickly. It lowers the threshold for participation, you know, the effort that's needed to connect with other you know, organizations, individuals, and so forth. And for a small social startup, it really enables them to tap into a vast network of you know, potential, you know, volunteer laborers, interested citizens, and you know, they can use text, you know, photographs, video as a way of communicating to a way much larger audience they would be able to reach otherwise. And so social media in this case becomes this great kind of equalizer that put small aspiring organizations at a more kind of equal footing together with the more established. And it's also a great tool for doing field work. Okay? And once I got to know a few people, I started getting invitations to go to all kinds of events. And so my weekend in Taipei was absolutely busy because there's so many events to look at, all through social media. The second characteristic is the role of a place. And you know, because I'm a landscape architect, and I am a designer, so I'm interested in this. Aspect. And so despite the popularity of social media, places are still important as a vehicle for social interaction, for people to meet, do things together, you know, develop a relationship. You know, in the case of the White Hut, you know, with neighbors and non-neighbors coming together, using the maker space, you know, exchange, you know, sharing knowledge about, you know, repairs. And that is really what creates this bond among people. But at the same time, it's important to know that even though, you know, places themselves are important, a lot of these activities are not necessarily place-bound in the sense is that in that they are not tied to a particular location. Okay? And so, for example, the volunteers at White Hut, they often work in other locations, okay, engaging, you know, many other people, okay, promoting their cause, you know, do the same kind of work that they do at the White House, but in different locations. Okay, so they are not bound to a particular community or particular neighborhood. And conversely, the same place can host different communities. Okay, so the ninth floor co-living apartment could be hosting, a social gathering. One day, together with the migrant workers. On a different day, it could be, a film screening, to a complete different audience, but happily in the same space. And so, in another word, we're looking at a much more kind of fluid network and relationship between different civil society groups and the spaces that they occupy, for either short-term or long-term basis. And so this happened with the way the ninth floor co-living apartments operates, and similarly with the emerging network of community makerspace in Taipei. And this is very different from the traditional or conventional practice of neighborhood or community planning, where the emphasis is often on a singular place-based community. Okay? And our society today has really kind of moved beyond that, even though there are still place-based activity, but the boundary has become much more open and fluid. And so people often simultaneously belong to different social groups and move from place to place. And this is kind of an example of that. So it's really more about building social relationship and the way spaces are used rather than the physical entities themselves. The next important characteristic that I would argue is the way these actually existing commons are often nested within the existing institutions. Okay, so very different from this kind of idealistic notion of common that is distinct from a state and market. Okay? It's a kind of autonomous kind of zone that somehow exists. The actual existing common actually exists within the institutions often, and even the market. Okay? And the relationship with the government and the market is often much more entangled than commons in the a kind of idealistic or conventional sense. And so, for example, many of the initiatives that are presented here actually have been supported with government funding. Okay? And this is one program that supported a lot of these different initiatives. It's called the Open Green Mansion Fund, a program that was created within the Taipei City government. So the White Hart got a small grant to fix up the building, and the same happened to the South Airport apartments. And the same with all the other cases that I mentioned before. And so it's a, the Mansion Fund program itself is very new. It's only like in this fourth year. Now, each year it supports about 10 to 20 different projects throughout the city, but over time it's building out this kind of collection of neighborhoods. An example in which people are experimenting with ways of building communities, engaging in kind of creative placemaking, term that we use here in this country. And the number is growing. The state agency and the Taipei City government also support an online open platform called Space Share Taipei that facilitates sharing of spaces throughout the city. So the ninth floor co-living apartment actually uses as a platform to identify location that they could possibly rent and then sublease to their tenants. And also to get, to attract kind of potential tenants to their space. The last characteristic I want to kind of address is the way that many of these new practices are still very much contested, primarily because they are still operating outside the typical and accepted social norm or regulatory domain. So for example, Fab Lab Taipei has to deal with complaints from neighbors, in regard to kind of noise, smell, and so forth. The ninth floor apartments have to deal with suspecting neighbors. What's going on with all these people coming in and out? And so they have to kind of keep a low profile, or sometimes they will try to engage neighbor, but in a very careful way. And also in the case of ninth floor apartments in particular, and there are other cases as well. So how does one balance between the business model and the social mission? Okay, so when you have nine locations, how do you ensure that each location live up to the goal of you're creating alternative community, okay? So those are the sort of issues that are still being kind of worked out. And so these are kind of, some observations of an ongoing process, an ongoing work in progress in the city. in which, you know, models, you know, relationship and constructs are still being developed, contested, and negotiated. But I'll argue that it is, you know, precisely through this process of experimentation, contestation, negotiation, that, that established norm and structures are being questioned, are being disrupted, and through which the new social assemblages are being constructed. And it is through this kind of entangled relationship with institutions, market, so forth, that acts of commoning can begin to influence social norms, values, institutions, and enable new meanings and relationship to emerge. And these are the ways that I believe through which the space of hope and the space of resistance can be created against the forces of neoliberal enclosure. Thank you. Sure. Questions? This gentleman, and then Susan.
Well, first of all, thank you for coming in today. I really enjoyed your presentation. It was really insightful. I had a question to you about a topic about, like, public space activism, or related to public space activism in the U.S. now. So you mentioned a lot of sort of, like, marginalized groups in society, such as homeless people and street vendors, or at least it was that way in, I believe, Taiwan, you mentioned?
Yeah.
I noticed there's, oftentimes there's gonna be a lot of information on the news about how homeless people don't really know where to, like, what space they're allowed to occupy, because, technically because they are homeless, they don't exactly know where they're allowed to stay and what is public and whatnot. So I feel like issues like that really blur the line between what is public and what isn't, like, where are you allowed to stand, where are you allowed to interact with people. And you mentioned that people simultaneously belong to different social groups, and that the way spaces are used rather than their physical entities themselves are what really matters. Mm-hmm. So my question is, could you comment on that? Like, how do you think we should be, like, setting rules on spaces? How should spaces like that be used? Like, you know, because you mentioned different spaces, like, you can meet in an apartment, or as you mentioned with the White Hut, you can meet in, like, a tool library. So can you comment on that?
Very good question. So in like urban governance, urban planning, management, and so forth, I mean, the traditional model of regulation is what we call command and control. So basically, you set a rule, you expect everybody to follow. If not, you get fined, or you know, some sort of kind of punishment that comes with it. And there's often very little negotiation, especially after the rule has been established. Okay, often there may be some sort of negotiation that lead to the establishment of the rule, but oftentimes once the rule is established, there's not much negotiation. And that creates problem because social condition changes. Like, you know, in Seattle, for example, you know, we didn't have so many homeless people before, but now we're at, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people on the streets. And so the rule that was established early on doesn't really address the condition that we are facing today. And so we need to be open to revisiting those rules, or maybe making, you know, exceptions, or some sort of, you know, negotiated agreements that operated outside this kind of command and control model. It's much more kind of sort of a negotiated, managed form of governance rather than this kind of command and control, you know, mode. So there are ways to do that that's already kind of recognized, but the way our city are designed and kind of, you know, governed often fail to kind of recognize that. So that's kind of one answer. Another answer is oftentimes, especially in country, you know, like Taiwan and other places where people are used to circumventing the rule, okay? It's part of the culture. You know, government says one thing, we figure out something else, right? And we can all coexist. It's not a problem at all. And sometimes the government actually wanted to keep it that way. because if they recognize something, if they recognize a problem, or if they have to deal with it. Okay, so it's better not to deal with a problem. It's better to externalize it. Okay, so that it doesn't incur costs within the institution. And this happened in a lot of development, context as well. Which actually it creates. I'm not saying this is all great. Okay, things that I think this also fall into this kind of neoliberal trap as well. But oftentimes it creates kind of this kind of niche, an opening that allow people to kind of self-organize and come up with better solutions, than what government could be able to come up with. For example, in Taiwan there are, I think anybody can set up a stall somewhere. They may have to pay like a fee to the mafia or to the police to operate their business. But the social system as a whole is much more flexible. If you lose a job. The saying in Taiwan is that if you lose a job, you can just become a street vendor. You might be able to make more money, definitely more than a professor. and that's the kind of social safety net that we often don't find much more in the kind of more advanced industrialized society. Yeah, Suzanne?
Yeah, this is really interesting. Thanks so much. Yeah. I'm thinking about some of the programs that you talked about, like, for example, the Southeast Asian Sunday.
Yeah.
So, it makes me a little uneasy because
it's sort of like, okay, great.
You know where I'm going with this.
Yes,
so
okay.
It's like, here we are, we Chinese folks, and we want you people over there to come and talk to us. Are there migrants that are involved at the center? Did they start at the center of the planning? Or is it still the in-group is inviting the out-group to come and, sort of token, come and talk to us for a little bit?
Right. So it didn't start out with Southeast Asia Sunday right away. This is a group of young people who are, Taiwanese. They happen to have, this particular guy, young person, lived in Philippines for quite some time. And so he has a much deeper understanding of the culture than most other people. And he wants to kind of give back to the group, his friend, basically. And so he created this social startup together with his friend. When they first started out, they would talk to that migrant worker in the train station, and people would say, who are you? But after some time, they begin to make some inroad into the community, and people recognize they're genuinely interested in helping migrant workers. So I understand that you could get into this very awkward situation. It's almost like a token, a migrant worker coming to kind of meet with you, and it could get very awkward very quickly. On that particular day, there were only two migrant workers, and there were like at least a dozen of young people, and so they realized that the image was not exactly the kind of image they want to present, to like a researcher, So they told me that it's not always that way. They offer more people, but it's actually very difficult for the migrant workers to. Even have a Sunday as a day off, and when they have a day off, they often want to have time for themselves. They want to meet with their friends. Why would you want to come and meet with a bunch of strangers, right? But the two ladies there, they actually became very good friends with the organizers of about 40. What I'm trying to kind of articulate is this kind of actual existing commons that what started out as kind of awkward, one-sided attempt to maybe come across some sort of social barrier. But it, at least it creates some sort of opening in which other actors can begin to become engaged. And then, you know, this kind of awkwardness can, you know, be questions, can be critique, and then they can find a better way of doing that. And from there, you know, we can, over time, you know, go to some another, to reach another stage when a more kind of inclusive notion of common can be accomplished. This gentleman in the back.
Thank you, I appreciate it. You know, I won't ask whether the migrants are on Facebook. But, but another thing that brings the folks together is food. That's kind of the common
food,
denominator.
Food, yes.
Otherwise, since the perpetuation of these programs is dependent on like corporate philanthropy,
some of them,
or government grants,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why do you call your book Diminishing Democracy?
Oh, no, so this is not part of the book. So the book,
Or is that a characteristic of the Southeast Asian countries? You see diminishing democracy in the South?
Diminishing democracy had to do with the phenomenon of, you know, global neoliberalization, the encroachment of corporate interests into the public institutions, so that, you know, government are becoming less accountable to the citizens because they are much more entangled with corporations and private interests. And so even when people are allowed to vote, they don't often have, you know, the full information, or they don't find the incentive to participate in the democratic process because, you know, media doesn't, you know, present a completely different story, or they don't feel that their vote matters, that sort of thing. So, and that that's a somewhat separate project than this one. Yeah, go ahead, Daniel. And then Greg.
Yeah, because, you know, I'm
okay,
going to
go
after,
okay.
So yeah.
Okay, maybe Greg can go.
I wanted to ask a question that's maybe thematically similar to Susanna's. You've acknowledged that these practices are contested.
Yeah.
I wonder to what extent are they, could they be critiqued? Put an even finer point on it.
Huh.
I'm thinking in particular of, I think it's the Stone Soup Group.
Right.
That creates food with and for the homeless.
Mm-hmm.
I find myself, since the election, trying to imagine the most pessimistic interpretation of any activity, just to try it out in my head. So with Stone Soup, I could see it's well-intentioned, it's great, it's participatory, but it's maybe not changing any of the conditions or structures that produce homelessness or food insecurity.
Right.
A really pessimistic interpretation might be that it's naive or even like slumming. Is there a social justice goal to these groups, or is the thought that in creating more social connectivity between people of different economic strata that leads to social change?
Right, right. So that's off. The kind of criticism that these types of work often receive, which is, you know, so how does this scale up?
Yeah.
How does this amount to some sort of structural change, right? And I would share the same criticism as well. And I look at a lot of these cases and I wonder, so what kind of, you know, what do they amount to? But in the process of interacting with people, in the process of kind of looking at how things can unfold, I mean, you do see more and more people becoming involved, like young people who would not have become involved otherwise. And the more people, you know, participate in this kind of process, I think there's a hope for some sort of structural change. And so, like in Taipei, for example, and I can talk about what happened in Madrid as well. So after the Sunflower Movement, Sunflower Movement was quite successful in terms of it actually stopped the trade agreement from being ratified by the legislature. But what has happened at an even more substantial level is the election that happened after that. So there's a huge kind of tidal wave of, there's a new kind of political consciousness that emerged after the movement. along with all these kind of new social startups. Okay? All these kind of social startups also feed into that in terms of kind of raising the political consciousness of younger generation. And so the ruling party was voted out and through a landslide. And so we now have a much more progressive government who are willing to implement kind of more supportive kind of social policy. And so this is only part of a much larger picture that does involve a structural change, at least through the electoral process, okay? And then the story of Madrid, and so after the 15M movement, okay, the May 15th movement, a lot of the activists who were involved in the Occupy movement went into the community. Okay, so Madrid had this history of very active neighborhood association, and so they do things like this as well, and they do creative placemaking and things like that. And so basically, they're going back into the grassroots and mobilize the grassroots, and then put in a progressive mayor in the following election, and can usher in a fundamental change in politics. But in terms of how these politicians actually perform after they get elected, that's a different story. At least they were able to get people engaged in the electoral process that led to some sort of structural change. So they are linkages that may not be as direct as we would like to see. And it may take even longer time. And this may not be entirely sustainable. It may be fashionable for a few years and then it kind of dissipates. But I'm hopeful. I mean, I tend to be a bit more optimistic than most other people. So when I see something like this, I feel really kind of empowered as somebody who's been studying these kind of phenomena and see actual people doing it and feel passionate about it. And that's there's nothing that can substitute. In the back and then come back. Yeah.
Thanks. It's sort of a kernel of a lot that's going, potential, but also it's stuck in a particular moment of time. I mean, I think your schema, maybe if you could add the start, protest.
Right.
Like, you started with getting mediated, but in fact, the way at least the arc of the narrative that you presented is that these people are an outgrowth of protests, mm-hmm. or Occupy,
right.
or mimicking these massive protests and trying to either materialize it in
mm-hmm.
certain types of practices.
Yes, yes, yes.
But and actually, there's a colleague in India who calls it occupancy urbanism.
Uh-huh.
And what's interesting about that is the temporal fragility of it, which is that in a lot of cases, people tend to occupy empty spaces, but those spaces are never permanently empty. So they set up a market, or they set up a business, or they put people who are foreclosed from housing. I mean, Madrid, the story is, the narrative that would be valuable for you is that the anti-foreclosure movement, where they actually occupy houses,
right.
and they fill it with people who became homeless because of the whole foreclosure
right.
movement. So there's a narrative there that links structurally to the with a structural critique of
yeah.
of financial crisis.
Yes.
But it's very temporary.
Yes.
It's an occupancy mm-hmm. form of urbanism. That means they're going to get kicked out at some point, either by the state, by the banks.
Mm-hmm.
And so at the end, it would be you have contested. And I'm just curious if you have examples from your
mm-hmm.
portfolio of
mm-hmm.
ideas of.
Uh-huh.
of people who actually had to fight back. I mean,
right.
the narrative is very sort of a happy ending here that everybody
right,
seems,
yeah,
it seems to be successful.
Right.
Most of these places around the world get closed down.
Right.
And so I'm just curious if you have some stories to suggest, way in which they reconcile the threat of the landlord or the threat of the state and
yeah.
try to negotiate that so the commons really become a political enterprise.
Right. So there is a chapter in the City on Silence book that deal with foreclosure issue in Spain, this particular to Barcelona. So there's a group that's basically an anti-eviction group. So they will block the eviction
yeah.
from happening. And also to bring what otherwise is a personal, private issue out in the public. And so I don't have all the detail, but take a look at the book when it comes out in July. Yes.
So we were assigned an article of yours to read for our class, and in it you seemed a bit critical of more and more public spaces becoming privatized.
Right.
But yet a lot of these beneficial organizations seem to be very private enterprises that have a public component.
Right.
So where does...
There's a difference between privatized and being enclosed, right? Or, you know, like a space that is being used by maybe private citizen or private party, but could remain open or deliberately kind of open and engaging. There's something that you have to pay a fee to get in, or you are just completely shut out. So in a lot of cases that I looked at are actually, this concept of private and public is also another social construct that is kind of problematic. Okay? So it favors this kind of institutions as opposed to something that is kind of self-organized. Right? So if you deem something that's private, then it's subjected that to this whole set of expectations and rules and so forth. So a lot of cases that I looked at is actually something that really kind of crossed between what is often defined as public and private. So this particular case, for example, it's a resettlement house. So it's the open space actually belong only to the residents, right? But because there's no gates or anybody can come in. And they use this as a kind of semi-public space for their events. It's hard to kind of pin this down in terms of where they belong, since this is a private space or a public space. And to me, what is more interesting is how that boundary becomes less important, and the relationship people become something that embody this idea of openness and sharing. And so I think we need to be, critical of where that boundary lies and what is often defined as public. Yes.
Yeah, it's a really intriguing work. And personally, it's wonderful to see this kind of communal aspirations and activities in my home country.
Oh, okay, okay.
And my question is more of a designer's question.
Sure.
So I noticed a lot of these cases, the setting is more ad hoc.
Yeah.
But I know there's quite a few spaces were really well designed, whether adopting the modern aesthetics or the vernacular Taiwanese aesthetics.
Uh-huh.
Are these all, were they all DIY, or were they involved professional designers to set up these?
The ones that I show up are more ad hoc. And there are also cases in which designers were involved. So this is actually not an interesting issue that, we have a few, designer type, friends. And they're also very into this kind of work, DIY and self-organized and things like that. But I come into the space and say, you guys need to do a better job. and so we often have this kind of debate and, conversation that, so they would, this friend of mine, Justin, he now set up this company and has been doing commission from the city, and he would do his version of this kind of thing, okay. But in this kind of hipsterish kind of aesthetics, which attracted a very different kind of audience, but they're becoming very popular. So I'm not trying to say one is necessarily better than the other. Because I think if they can, an audience can find meaning and attachment to those kind of spaces, all the power, to that, right? But that also creates an interesting, space for dialogue. Mm-hmm. So how do you, what is the aesthetic, what is the aesthetics of, DIY? What is the aesthetics of, grassroots? And where is that aesthetic, coming from, and how can we critique it? What language can we use to critique, space like this? And those are really interesting topics that we can talk more about. But that's, it's really great that you pointed that out. Okay, any other?
Awesome.
Okay, now, okay. Okay, get to
I asked one of my many questions. And it follows up a little bit on Greg's comment, but also it turns around a question you asked me when we're having coffee and I didn't really answer. And I'll preface my question by saying that, you know, the conversation, the, your point about how these grassroots initiatives trickled onto the politics and the elections reminded me of something I read right after the presidential elections here, and some I don't know, political analyst or activist was saying how, you know, the Democratic Party needs to start with the grassroots.
Yeah.
That it lost that touch. And then they were making, they were creating examples, like it's not like grassroots of like, let's go door to door with a political poster. It's like, let's get involved in people's needs. What do they need in the everyday, and how can we help your need? Like, you know, you need food, or you need to fix your, and so I hadn't thought about it that way, but when you made that point, I was like, well, there's someone coming from the political side saying that's how you're gonna get them, that effect of like trickling up. And so that's a preface to my question, which is that question you asked me, which is, how do you make that call when you are, you know, analyzing so many different initiatives, that which ones do offer this space of hope and resistance that can change, and which ones become co-opted as a way of, I don't know, embellishing the city, tourism, or becoming a trend that's not really reaching to the, or just making people feel good, but not, how do you, for each one, make that call?
That's a really good question. I think, I mean, this is actually, it's not a new question in terms of, I mean, from somebody who's been looking at, you know, like public participation, you know, like public participation can easily become a form of tokenism, right? It could be co-opted. And so the question is, who is in control, right? So who gets to make the decision, okay? So if a project is like this, the decision is made by some government official rather than by the organizer themselves or the residents. That's where you draw the line, okay? In terms of where the project failed, right? If the project doesn't really contribute to that capacity building, if people don't feel empowered, if they don't get to make decisions, they just make something beautiful, then other people take credit. And that's where you really have to draw the line. And that's where you, in the process of doing a project, you want to make sure, you know, that you are doing something that contributes to the community, not just in terms of creating the space, you know, for the people, but actually engage them in the process so they can take ownership of that space, they can become, they can be in control of what they're doing. And so you are, you know, people have the agency, have the ability to go from here, you know, to address, you know, the question that Greg, you know, raises, the structural change, right? How do you go from someplace, you know, like this, you know, to another place, you know, in terms of having greater capacity to affect changes? So that's where I would draw. Okay, any other?
A small question is just kind of thinking about that discussion and your experience, say, serving on the jury.
Yes.
Looking at those various applicants, what would you say are the things that distinguish the projects that the Green Space funded and the ones that were not selected?
So actually, almost all the projects got selected. They actually, so the person who is in charge of that project, there's a team of them. So they actually had to go out and recruit communities to come and apply for this grant. Because it's a lot of work to get a project like this done. And people who do this kind of work know that there's not enough money for any kind of thing that we do. And also, to fill out, it's a government grant. So there's all these paperwork that you need to do to fill out. And the community don't often have, at least initially, don't have the kind of capacity to do that. So they often have to fill out their paperwork for the community who apply for the grant. And that in that particular round, there was only one project that got rejected because it was a private space and it was on the rooftop. So there's, going back to your question, sometimes private space can work but if it's on rooftop, then there's no way for people to get to it. And so we thought that they need to find a different site. And so we told them to come back and apply in the next round when you find a more appropriate site. And so so that's that particular instance. Maybe hopefully in a few years we'll become more selective. But at this stage, because they're only starting out, they really have to go out and recruit applicants.
Any final questions? Well, thank you very much. And,